unto the redemption of the purchased possession, unto the praise of his glory. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, tonight, dear God, in your sight. And Lord, as we go through this, we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would ground us in the Bible. And so, Lord, we ask, Heavenly Father, for your wisdom. Thank you, dear God, that, Lord, these are not my truths, but these are your truths. And I pray, Heavenly Father, that, Lord, you would help us to receive them. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Thank you. Be seated, if you would. And so, as already made mention tonight, we have the gospel, the benefit of the gospel. We have that transformation. Well, what a benefit it is to know that God transforms us. Amen. And so we don't know anything what it means to live as a child of God unless we get it from our Bible. And a lot of people today, they're trying to decipher the Bible. And I've seen in my short Christian life where people, they pick out certain verses in the Bible and they try to stay with those verses. And they try to take and expound on that. And I've seen it myself. And then I've even heard elderly men speak of the same thing. And yet I've seen it with my own eyes and with my own heart. And the more that I want to learn the Bible, the more I let the Bible itself interpret. And yet God is able to do that. He's able to take you from one passage and show you another. And so we just got to learn how to dig in, learn how to study. But what it is for us tonight to have a benefit, that God not only transform us, but what I want to get in tonight, that as and that is that not only that the gospel it transforms us, but it also preserves us, amen. And it preserves us in some ways. And so we're going to try to bring out some verses tonight that will speak of this. And so look with me at verse 13, if you would, and I want to focus in this part right here. But notice how the Bible says in verse 13, in whom ye also trusted. See, salvation comes when you and I begin to trust. Eh? We trust the word of God. Salvation cannot come in any other way. Right? Salvation is not some prayer. Say a prayer after me and you're saved. That is not salvation. If a person is going to get saved, a person is going to trust the word of God, and they're going, trusting with the word of God with everything they have. I heard a preacher preach one time, it's like when you get to the end of the rope, and you're climbing down a long building, and you get to the end of the rope, and you can't go no more because you ran out of rope. Well, you're just going to trust God to catch you when you let go. And so that's what salvation is. We can't save ourselves. We just got to let go and let God catch us. And becoming a Christian, learn how what a Christian is supposed to be is simply allowing God, trusting God to lead you to be the right kind of person. And so we could say whatever we want, but God's a gentleman and he leads every one of his children. I like this part. He doesn't always do it with a rod. He'll do it with a staff. He'll do it to simply just kind of, you know, nudge you just a little bit. And you ought to respond to that touch of that staff, right? And I remember when I was growing up, my dad didn't nudge us. He just took the rod to us, amen? And so we only responded to the rod, but you know, God's a loving God, and I don't like this part where people say that God doesn't love. I think he's the God of love, and I think that we need to understand that, yes, he is a God of judgment, but he's also a God of love. I mean, you can't take that out of the Bible, for God so loved the world. You cannot erase that. You can't dismember that God is a God of love. And do I understand all his love? Do I understand what it means? No, I don't. There's times that when we sin our life and we let something control us, and yet God comes with His grace. He touches with that staff. I don't want you to do this. I don't want you to go that way. And God, He's a merciful God, a gracious God, and we don't understand all that. And so I'm saying all this to you tonight because we need to see some things that this God of heaven, this God of creation, that who He is. And the Bible teaches that He is a loving God. You know, my heart responds to that. And your heart responds to that too, because if it didn't, you wouldn't be here. If it didn't, you wouldn't try to do anything about love. You would just simply follow Satan. But yet, love came into your heart, and love responded, and you responded to that love, and yet you submitted yourself under that love. And so I'm saying to you tonight, just like the Bible says, no clearer than I can ever say it myself. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. According as He has chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame, there it is, before Him in love. So that's the kind of people that God simply expects out of you and I. Oh, don't get me wrong, folks. There's problems on every side. I mean, everywhere you go, it's always a problem. I mean, problems of this and problems of that. And I remember the church that we came from. I really believe that the preacher had an outgoing problem, but I think he had a little ought with me. And that is because we came there and found out that the man dyes his hair, and they want to know what the secret was for me, because I didn't dye my hair. And so I think he had a little ought with me, because I didn't dye my hair. My hair is just as black as it can be. And so I'm saying to you tonight that you and I, if we have ought with one another, which we do, we're going to, it can't get around that. But that idea of working things in love. And so I'm saying to you tonight, because this gospel, this benefit of the gospel, it preserves you and I. And as we're going to be looking in this preservation of the gospel and what it means to us, here the Bible says that in whom ye also trusted, verse 13, after that ye heard the word of truth, God loves you. Isn't that nice to know that that's all you need? God loves you. Amen. But you know, not everybody receives that. Not everybody responds to that. We know that the Bible says that some are saved by compassion and some are saved by fear. Some are saved by the staff, a little nudge. And some are simply saved by the welting of the rod. And you say, well, what does all that mean to me? Well, we all respond differently. But no matter how we respond, it should always be in love. No, notice this. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Here it is. In whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So there's that preservation about after we get saved. Now, again, if you're going to get saved, if anybody's going to be saved, it must first come by trusting. Amen. That death, that burial, that resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? Don't be ashamed of that. Preach it. Let it live out in your life. Did you know that as believers, we are to, in a form, we are to be like God, and that is to hate sin, right? And so let's just go through this, and I want to try to bring out tonight some of this preservation, or how the Holy Spirit, how He preserved us when He sealed us. And so I want to try to bring that out tonight if I could. And so So some could ask, well, what are the promises of the Holy Spirit? Well, according to Ephesians, we find that there it is. It says, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. See, I bought me a box of color pencils, and I've been going through, and when I really studied for the message, and I kind of mark it out, and but I marked this out here, that ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise in red. You say, well, why would you put it in red? Well, because it is a part of the deity of Jesus Christ. You got the God, the deity, the Trinity. And so you got God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They all are different, but there's not one that is more powerful than another. And you say, what do you mean, preacher? Well, they all work in unison, amen? And they all working together. All three in one. One God, amen? But I marked it red because anything that comes with God, dealing with in our life, it should always be red because it is under the blood, amen? And so these are some verses tonight, if you would, to go with me. We're not going to go fast tonight. We're going to go slow. And when we get past that time to go, you just get up and walk out. When there ain't nobody here, then I'll quit preaching. All right? And John chapter 16 is where we're going. All right? John chapter 16. And look with me. Start reading the verse 11. John chapter 16. Verse 7, I meant. Verse 7. John chapter 16, verse 7. All right? Bible says in verse 7, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. Don't you like that? When somebody says, I'm going to tell you the truth. Hey, amen. Right? I would rather hear somebody tell, I'm going to tell you the truth right now, and I would rather know the truth. Amen. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. If I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And so we find that this is a promise of Jesus that if he goes away, he will send that Comforter. That Comforter is the one who has sealed us in the family of God. And you know, that cannot be taken away. You know, that cannot be taken away at all. And aren't you glad for that? I know I am. I remember some things that I have said after salvation, and I didn't understand it. I didn't understand God's love, and but God saved me, and when he did, he sealed me with that Holy Spirit of promise. And so look with me as verse 8, John chapter 16, verse 8. And when he has come, here it is, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. And so here the Holy Spirit, there are some things that what he does in our life as he assists us and as he becomes our as he advocates for us on the interests of Jesus Christ, we find that he reproves the world of sin, right? Now, so that's the Holy Spirit's job, okay? And but then also, and of righteousness. And I believe that's where God, the Holy Spirit works in our life, because God wants us to be in the image of Jesus Christ. And so you say, preacher, what do you mean? Well, I'm saying to you tonight that the image of Jesus Christ wasn't where as he was accused in the Bible. He was a wine bibber. He was gluttonous, right? And he stayed with the publicans. In other words, the sinners and all that, right? And like they were accusing him that he was partaking of their sin. And that's not who Jesus Christ was, right? And so you and I, we are to be that image of Jesus Christ. When the world looks into our life, they are to look and understand that we are the disciples of Jesus Christ. And then of the judgment, right? And so we find that it is the Holy Spirit's job to reprove the world. You know, you could go, if you would like, and you can go into every home, and you could try to change their habits, but you and I can't change anybody. Not one person we can change. And just like this, and I'll explain this to you. Just like this, did you know the devil cannot make you sin? Right? He cannot do it. And if you sin, I tell you how you sin. The devil has put that thought into your mind, and he has done it on a regular basis, and he has done it so much to where you take that thought and it becomes your own, and then he makes you think that sin is good, and so you'll go ahead and think, well, man, I see the good points of this. How can it harm me? And you'll partake of that sin. And so I'm saying tonight, the devil don't make you sin, right? We sin on our own, right? And so what I'm saying to you is that we can go around and we can try to change people, but unless you and I are become the people like God wants us to, right? We can never be the right influence, right? And so what I'm saying tonight is that it is the Holy Spirit's job to, there it is, reprove the world of sin, and then of righteousness. That's where you and I is. So what kind of righteousness do you have? What kind of righteousness do I have, right? If my righteousness is better than yours, then I'm not righteous, right? If your righteousness is better than mine, then you're not righteous, right? The only righteousness that we have is when you and I obey the word of God, and when we simply understand that the word of God is what has the authority, right? And so there's that understanding of righteousness, and then of judgment, right? So folks, judgment is coming into this world, and perhaps maybe today we're beginning to see a little bit more of it. Why you know, about how the way the world is coming about today, more folks, they're grasping, they're groping more for sin. They want their way. One day God will give it their way, right? I just pray that you and I aren't here when that happens. And then John chapter 6, verse 13 with me, if you would, look with me. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you, I like that, amen, into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he shall show you things to come. And so there's a promise there that the Holy Spirit will simply show you the truth, amen? And so tonight, we need to, as we look back into the Bible, and I'm just going to read this. Keep you there, place in John. We got a couple more verses. But as the Bible says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. And so we find that the Holy Spirit, he is going to lead us into all truth. Amen. And so I believe that the Holy Spirit does that. Amen. And you say, well, what about my life? How come I got these problems? Well, we got these problems because perhaps we're not listening to the Holy Spirit, right? And I can never judge or say something about the way my life is, right? And in other words, if I don't like the way my life is, then God's trying to show me something. You see? And so So in other words, I'll give you this story. I remember when working years ago on a roof, and this man, he was older than I was, and he came to work, and he found out that I was a Christian, and you know, he seemed to be a nice guy. I mean, really nice guy. And we were working, and you know, I would buy him lunch, and when he had money, he would sometimes buy me lunch, and you know, and stuff like that, you know. And you know, after about a couple months, I got to the point where I stopped liking him. I got to the point where I just couldn't stand him. Now I didn't hate him or nothing like that. Hatred's very strong. I just didn't want to be around him. And finally, you know, just after going through several weeks of that, began to look inwards. Why is this guy? I mean, he's not good. He wasn't a good worker, right? And I told the boss man, and they just kept sending him with me, and he got to go to work with other people, and they complained about him, and so. I began to wonder, why, Lord? Why me? Why am I stuck with this guy? Right? And you say whatever you want, but it's like God just simply, I mean, just hit that button play, and I heard that recording, and it came into my ears, and just like God says, well, I don't like your life. I don't like the way you're living. And I got to thinking about it, understanding the conversation that me and that guy had, and then I realized, you know, maybe I need to change. And you know, once I began to make my heart, make my mind up, my heart, and I began to make some changes, you know, that guy simply just went away. Can't explain it, but I will tell you this, that God works in our life in ways that sometimes we're just simply discouraged, or we don't want to deal with it, but God's working in our way, in our life, because he wants to work out truth, right? There it is in, where was I? Verse 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, you notice that? Whatsoever he shall hear, right? So the Holy Spirit, he gets it, his command, right, from somebody else, right? Perhaps he gets it from Jesus, and Jesus gets it from God. Whatever how you say that, you see that that works in unison, right? We get it from a Holy Spirit. He comes, and whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come, right? So you believe that? Bible tells right there, it could be true, right? So I'm saying to you tonight, you ever see sometimes when you go through things in life and you simply just had an understanding, you know, that you went through and you said, man, I knew that was going to happen. I just knew it. And it happens, right? Or you just, you know, we call it sixth sense, or we call it some deep emotional sense or whatever, you know. But you know, if you and I had a more time of hearing the Holy Spirit in our life, I think it would settle our hearts, right? Well, we got folks today, they're settled, they're running to and fro, they're running over to this person, running over that person, going over to tell these people, they're going everywhere telling everybody about their problems. But they're not telling. But they got the same problems, and they go year after year after year, same stuff, same old thing, and you wonder why it's like that. Well, perhaps somebody's not listening to the Holy Spirit, right? So notice what the Bible is saying: whatsoever he shall hear, that he shall speak. You ever heard the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart? Now don't answer that. I mean, you should know that. You should know the answer. And if you haven't heard the Holy Spirit speaking to your heart, then you're not hearing, right? You got a hearing problem. And so we find that these promises, they come from the Holy Spirit. I'll go back with you. And I'll read that part in red that I ascribed to you earlier. Ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. And so we're talking about some of these promises and how the Holy Spirit preserves us. Amen. And then John chapter 15, if you would. John chapter 15. All right, and look with me in verse 26. John chapter 15, verse 26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the... Here it is. You want to know where the Holy Spirit gets his commands from? There it is. Whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father. And here's this promise. Okay, this is Jesus speaking. This is the promise that he's given. He shall testify of me. Okay, you want to know some more things about Jesus Christ? Get along with the Holy Spirit, and he'll tell you, right? And that's why I heard some folks say that if you ever want to hear from God, then you must be on praying ground, right? You must be on praying ground. So here, the Holy Spirit, he gets his command from God the Father, and yet we can know the very heart of God if we took time, if we were prepared ourselves to be able to hear from the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm saying this to you tonight because if the Holy Spirit is a person, then apparently... All persons that I have discovered in my life, they have feelings, right? And so if the Holy Spirit is a person, the third person of the Trinity, then don't you think that he has some feelings, right? Now, you saying, what are you saying, preacher? Well, I mean, let's just talk about it, right? You ever went to somebody and you open up your heart and you try to tell them how you feel and in their own way, they rejected you. They wouldn't hear what you had to say. They wouldn't open up their eyes and their hearts so they can look in to see who you really are, right? And in their actions, you can tell that, well, they weren't paying attention. So let's just throw it out there. Do you like rejection tonight? I mean, if you like rejection, praise God for you, man. You're an awesome individual. You know, I know that's not true. Not one person in this room likes rejection. Neither does the Holy Spirit. But oftentimes, we don't get that, that we don't have that need fulfilled into our hearts because we're not willing to hear the Holy Spirit. We're ready to go out and we're ready to evangelize in the name of Jesus. We're ready to go out and conquer through the blood of Christ. We're ready to go through all these things, but hear what the Spirit had to say, you know? And so I'm just saying to you tonight, according to the Word of God, that it would be more profitable for us that if we would be able to hear. Now, notice what the verse says once again. But when the Comforter is come, he has to come into your life. Amen. He cannot come into one's life until that individual trusts in Jesus, in whom ye also trust, right? So we must know that we have trusted Jesus. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. So there is an understanding that this Holy Spirit of God, he testified of who Jesus Christ is. Spoke to a friend about a week ago back home, and he says, Robert, I've been discovering more and more as I, live my life and speak to people about Christ. I've been discovering more and more that a lot of them say that they're saved by Jesus Christ. They're saved by the blood of Jesus Christ, but they don't believe that he's God. Said it can't happen. I said, brother, that person ain't saved. He goes, I know. And so I'm saying to you tonight that the Holy Spirit testify who Jesus Christ is. Amen. Now never forget that Jesus Christ, he came having compassion on people. Amen. And so I want to say to you tonight that you and I must or should have compassion on people. And so we need to learn how to be able to work with people and teach them and show them what the Bible says. Because see, it's not about you and it's not about me. It's about testifying about Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, if you and I were to simply surrender unto the Holy Spirit, I believe with all my heart, according to the Word of God, that the Holy Spirit will teach you how to testify about Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we look into the Bible, we find out all these parables, and we find out these stories, and we find out all of these things about Jesus Christ, wherein the Bible says that that not even the books in the world could contain all the things that Christ did, right? And so so there's a lot to learn about Jesus Christ. But if you're going to learn anything about Jesus Christ, if you're going to learn about the heart of the Father, you're going to hear it from the Spirit. He's going to speak into your ears and tell you what you need to know. I really believe in my own life that a lot of the mistakes is simply because I ignored the Spirit of God speaking to me. I don't know about it. Man, I can handle it. Oh, all right. And, you know, after so many times of being rejected, the Holy Spirit goes off and does his own thing. Stands in. That's why the Bible says, grieve not the Holy Spirit, right? And so the Holy Spirit just, okay, fine. You know, you have it your way. And he just, I don't know how he does it. But he stops his influence. He stops badgering you. He stops trying to get in your way, trying to stop you from going a direction. And he'll just simply stop. We don't want that. Amen. Because, you know, that's a poor place for a Christian. I don't want that. Amen. And I pray that that I could get my heart right. And so if I ever come to that state, I pray that God will help me to be able to stir up those gifts of God. Amen. Those things that God wants me to do. Now go with me also to John chapter 14, if you would. And these are just some promises. John chapter 14. And I'd like to be able to look there in verse 16 and 17. The Bible says in verse 16, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. And so we find here, according to verse 16, that promise that is for by the Spirit of God, and that is that he may abide with you forever. Amen. And so this is a continual preservation. Amen. And so that's why we can, when we read the Word of God, I mean, it just strengthens us, and it fills our hearts and our minds and our souls, because the Spirit of God, he's there abiding in us, and he's going to abide with us forever. Amen. Think about that. Amen. That even so, we're in heaven. All evil's conquered. Right? We got our eyes on Jesus Christ. Right? We understand the whole Trinity. We understand everything. And yet, here the Bible says that the Spirit of God is going to abide with us forever. What an amazing factor that even though when we get to heaven, we're still going to have the Spirit in a part of us. Amen. And I think that that's where we can go back to, if you would, Ephesians chapter 1. And look with me in verse 13. All right. Now, the Bible says, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom you all also after that you believe, here it is, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Right? Aren't you glad tonight that you're sealed? I'm sealed. Anybody that received Jesus Christ as Savior is sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. And yet, we're not just sealed, but that He abides with us forever and ever and ever. I think that that's a great thing, amen. And so, this sealing that the Holy Spirit does, this sealing becomes the Christian or the believer's identity. Okay, so let me explain that to you. It's just like back in the days when they had kings and queens and all of that, and a king, he wrote out an official letter, and on that letter, he had that ring that he would take that ring and they would pour wax on that letter, and he would take that ring and he would just squish it down, right? And when he removed it, you can see an imprint of the king's ring. And that was considered that sealing, right? So that sealing was simply that an identification. The sealing that we have from God today of the Holy Spirit is that identification. And so we find that this identification, it comes to our understanding that when the king put his sealing on that envelope or that official papers, that official papers became the property of the king. Now, when you get saved, there you're saved by that sealing of the Holy Spirit of promise. When you get saved and you're sealed by the Holy Spirit, you're sealed as the king's property. Amen? What a tremendous testimony that how the Holy Spirit, He works into our life. He seals us, amen? And when He seals us, that sealing is an identification that we are the king's property. Amen? It's got to be much better than what you're leading on to, amen? I'm saying to you tonight that we understand that the Spirit takes up residence, but, even so that people in your own home you fight with, amen? You fight with people that's living in your house because they want their way and you want your way, and art be like that, right? And it should be that mutual understanding, amen? And that mutual, that mutual understanding that we want, and as we're resonance, that we're working in truth, that we're working in love, right? That we'll be holy and without blame and before Him in love. If we did that, the Bible teaches that it will get along better. Amen? And so, when we understand whose property we are, in other words, right, if I'm the property of the Father, of the King, and you're the property of the Father, or the King, right? And, well, I didn't like what you did to me, so I went and flattened your tires. Right? And you say, well, why would you do that? You offended me, and when there's all this squabble, because that's all it ends up, right? And I flattened your tire. Well, you don't need to rest on that. Don't worry about your flattened tires, because you got to understand something. Okay, and this is what I'm trying to bring out, that if you're the property of the King and I'm the property of the King, and I go and do something to you, well, then the King will take care of me, right? Why? Because, well, I have disrupted his property, right? So the Bible says that God is no respecter of persons. Amen. And so if you're God's property, then I must treat it as God's property, right? I must respect that this is my Father's property, right? Not only respect it, but take care of it. Amen. And so we think about how we do things like that around the church, right? People don't like it. Because we're pushing more and more, no sodas, no crackers, no this and that in the sanctuary. Why? Because it's God's property, right? And we want to respect that. And so we find that we can understand that when the Spirit takes up residences, right? You're saved, I'm saved. Then we become God's property. We are to respect one another. Amen. So I'm saying this to you tonight because the Bible is teaching that these are some promises that sealing that the Holy Spirit does is our identification that we're saved and yet we're God's property. Now, we think about the primary marks of the believers, and we can think of two of them, and that is that the believer is to continue on in obedience, right? We believe that. I'm much happier as a believer when I'm obedient to doing the things God called me to. Amen? No different than you. But when we're not obedient, what happens? Well, we find the chastening of the Lord. We want those blessings, but we don't want to be disciplined, and so it's better to trust and obey as the song goes. Amen. Go with me to John chapter 8, if you would. John chapter 8. And just going to go through a couple verses tonight. John chapter 8. I'd like to look in verse 31, if you would. John chapter 8, verse 31. Okay. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. And so you see that identification comes out as a believer. That believers of the gospel, they're going to continue in the word of Jesus Christ. Okay. And then we find that if they continue in the word of God, right, we find what Jesus said to them, then are you my disciples, if you continue in my word. So we find that believers, they are to continue in the word of God, right? And so we discovered that. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. All right, 1 John chapter 2, verse 19. All right, verse 19. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, here it is, they would have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not all of us. So the real thing that we want to get from here, these people, that they were continuing with the disciples or with the Lord Jesus Christ. And here it says that not every one of them were with them. And so you think about how Jesus fed the multitude. Think about how Jesus fed those that at one given time. We know that on two different accounts, one for 5,000 and another for 4,000. I mean, feeding these people at one time, just with a little amount of loaves of bread and a little amount of fishes. And yet, they did not all continue on with following after Jesus, right? In the end, we even seen that Jesus asked his disciples, will you two not go away, right? And so what I'm saying to you that as believers and as our identity, okay, we continue on doing or following the Lord Jesus Christ. And we do that even when others simply go away, right? So we say, what does all that mean? Well, that sealing of the Holy Spirit causes us to not want to leave the things of Christ, to not go away, to always abide in the truth, right? And so we find that. Go with me to Hebrews chapter 12, if you would. Now this is a little bit more lengthy here, in Hebrews chapter 12. So there's a little bit more verses here, but we can handle it. Amen. All right, Hebrews chapter 12. Look with me. Start reading the verse 5. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5. Okay. Verse 5, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, therefore all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For a few days chastened us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceful fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Now there's a lot that was we were going through here, and the ideal of it is that if you're sealed with the Holy Spirit and you wanted to know or understand that how to be identified that you're God's child, well, here it is. You could go to this anytime and you can question yourself that when I sin, that God chastening me. And so we find that God only chastens his children. He doesn't go and try to bring reverence into the children of God. I mean, into the devil's children. He doesn't try to bring reverence into their life, but he does try to bring reverence in his children, right? And so we've been corrected by our fathers of the flesh, and we received that correction. Well, why wouldn't we receive the correction of our own Heavenly Father, right? Now, think of this. Go with me to verse 10 and consider this tonight. All right? Here, the writer is speaking this. He says, for they verily, for a few days, chasten us after their own pleasure. Now, understand this. Okay? As we have had fathers or dad correct us, they did it for their for an understanding that, well, my dad always taught me, son, you're going to obey me in my house. And if he had to get up and he had to spank me, I mean, he didn't. And he did it with an understanding that if you do it again, it's going to be worse. Right? But you know, he did that because he didn't want to have to be telling me all the time the same thing. I tell you, I was really, I think I was really rebellious in some given time. But I used to get in trouble climbing on people's roofs. And my dad told me several times, don't get on people's roofs. Well, I didn't think that it was no big thing about it. So I would always climb on people's roofs. Well, he seen me on the roof one day, and I guess it was for his own pleasure. He took that belt and he wore me out with it too, amen. And I'm saying that to you not to bring disgrace on my dad, but he did it because he didn't want to keep telling me. He didn't want to keep disciplining me. But notice what God does. Notice it says, after their own pleasure, but he for our own profit. So God doesn't spank us for pleasure. He spanks us for his own profit, for our own profit, right? I'll tell you, you'll know the difference between when God spanks you and some man spanks you, right? And so I'm saying this tonight. I want you to consider this, that the ceiling that God, that those promises, that ceiling that, let me get back this, get my words right now. The ceiling that the Holy Spirit does, those promises that he gives us, we can understand those promises when we go to these scriptures like this. But that ceiling, to know that we are God's child, that when we sin, there's that promise, we're going to be corrected, right? And we're not going to be corrected for pleasure, but we're going to be corrected for our own profit. And so I'm saying this tonight because these are some promises that the Holy Spirit works out into our life, right? So we know that as the Bible says in verse 11, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous but grievous. Nobody wants to be chastened of the Lord, but God doesn't. And he's not doing it for some mere pleasure, but he's doing it so that we could have profit in our life. And so what are some things that God is doing into our lives tonight? Amen. And so we can consider some of those things. Go with me to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. All right, Matthew chapter 7, we find that this could be a promise into our life. Matthew chapter 7. Okay. That sealing of the Holy Spirit does a lot of things into our life. Matthew chapter 7, verse 20 is where we're going to. Okay, real short verse. We can memorize this one, amen. All right, verse 20. Wherefore, by their fruits ye shall know them. So that's a promise that the Holy Spirit gives into our life, that you can know who's saved, you can know who's not saved, because you can tell by the fruits. And who's gonna reveal their fruits to you? The Holy Spirit, right? So he promises that he's going to give that truth to us. He promises that we can know other people, and we can know them by their fruits. So the fruit of people, they're lining up in the Bible some way. Could either be good or evil. I don't know, but I'm not here to judge people. Amen. I'm not here to want to judge people, and that's not what we're here for. Amen. We're here to share the gospel. All right. And 1 John chapter 3. 1 First John chapter 3. All right. All right, 1 John chapter 3, if you would. Okay. Aren't you glad you can go back and look at these verses later? I know we're covering a lot of verses tonight, but 1 John chapter 3, and look with me in verse 9, if you would. Whosoever is born of God doeth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. Okay? Now, there's two ways of looking at this. Okay? And one way is that it's being taught here that those who are a Christian, either they do not sin habitually, right? They do not sin in a habitual way, or they have arrived to a perfection. That's what the Bible's teaching, right? Now look at it again. Whosoever is born of God doeth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Now, you know, I understand that in some of the ways that when the Bible's teaching here, that when you got saved and the Holy Spirit sealed you, that inner man that we are living in, that inner man cannot sin because he is of God. But it doesn't say anything about that fleshly man, right? So we got to look at it as understanding between the spirit and the flesh. The spirit cannot sin, but the flesh man can. And so you and I, we need to determine who we're going to live. We're going to live walking in the spirit, or we're going to live walking in the flesh. Now, neither one of us, I would say, have arrived to a state of perfection. Okay? So, you say, what do you mean, preacher? Well, I'm saying to you tonight that we all have that battle of sin in our life, even after salvation. And, you know, so today, if you've been saved 40 years, then you haven't arrived to a perfecting state, but you should be better than what you were, right? I hope that I'm making that really clear. So let's just go to 1 John chapter 2, and we could pick it up here. All right, you're right there already. In my Bible, just right across the page. Notice what 1 John chapter 2. Now, I'm gonna split hairs right here if I'm not careful, so you bear with me. My little children, these things I write unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So, we need to understand that we all sin, right? And it should be something that we need to understand tonight. And that is, we're describing these this sealing. And in this sealing of the Holy Spirit, it identifies us with God as a child, that we're in God's family. Now, if we have been saved, the Bible says that we can have that advocate of the Father, and that is Jesus Christ. He is that propitiation. And so we need to understand that in this two cases, okay, we either have arrived, as 1 John chapter 3 verse 9 is teaching, we either have arrived to a state of perfection, or we have or we have not have no habitual sins in our life. Okay, now we know that we have not arrived, right? So it would show the manner that we do deal with sin in our life. And I'm saying this to you because you may know how to deal with the sin in your life, but others may not. And those ones that may not know how to deal with sin in their life, how do we know their heart? We don't. The Bible says that we can know them by the fruits. The Bible says tonight that the truth, that the Holy Spirit will reveal the truth, right? So what he hears, he'll speak. So what I'm saying to you tonight is that we need to rest ourselves in the Bible, what the Bible's saying. Now, if someone has sinned and they are saved, well, then they can get it right, right? They can pray to the through the blood of Jesus Christ, and they can get it right. Amen. But so can the terminology is, if a person isn't saved, they can get saved. Amen. And they can get it right. So you and I need to really understand the fruit of people. And as we understand the fruit of people, it's our job as a Christian to carry out the image of Jesus Christ. Not only that we carry out the image of Jesus Christ, but we also carry out the knowledge, because when Jesus Christ was here and he was in his ministry, you remember that the Bible says that he went up into the wilderness 40 days, 40 nights, and he was tempted, and he came down. Got baptized, right? No, he got baptized first, went up there, and he came and got tested. But what I'm saying to you, that all through his ministry, Jesus had the Holy Spirit with him. And so I'm saying to you tonight that in our ministry, in our lives, once we say we have the Holy Spirit with us, and so he helps us to become the image of Jesus Christ. And he helps us to know wisdom. And so we can know the fruit of people, but we have to be able to hear it from the Spirit of God. Now, these are, there's five things that we're going to rest assured tonight. And that is these five desires that believers have if they're saved. Number one, that's to please God. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. Wherefore we labor, that, whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. Our desire is to please God. And that should be the heart of every believer, is to please God. Number two, to know God's word. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile, and hypocrisies and envyings and all evil speakings, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. So we are to know that we are God's children, to know that we are been sealed. We are to have that desire to be pleasing God. Number two, to know God's word. And then number three, to be with God's people. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. And so we find to please God, to know God's word, to be with God's people, and then number four, to share the gospel. So the gospel is that, and Jesus, Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 and 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I command you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. So we are to share the gospel, and then third, and then fifth of all, to overcome sin. I believe that we can go back to 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, where the Bible says, "For whosoever is born of God doeth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God." It should be a desire in our hearts to want to overcome sin. Now, these are just an identity to know that we have been sealed by that Holy Spirit of promise. And so we can understand that God does gives us some comparisons, and you can write these down, some comparisons to know if we're walking in the Spirit or if we're walking in the flesh. We could go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, verses 19 through 24, where it gives that description, the works of the flesh versus the works of the fruit of the Spirit. Okay? And then we could go to James chapter 3, verse 12 through 18, where the Bible speaks that we can know the wisdom from below, or we can have the wisdom from above. Okay? You can pick and choose which one you want. Okay? That's your choice. Nobody can tell you how to live your life. You have to make that choice. Number three, Ephesians chapter 5. Verse 5 through 11, the Bible speaks about the works of darkness versus the fruit of the light. Okay? And then we know that in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 and 11, where the Bible says, "Know ye not?" And we're talking about knowing that we're not in the Spirit. And so that it speaks about the unrighteous life. And so we are to know these things. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 6, if you would, we'll turn over real quick. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. All right. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves of mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So we find that that there's that description, and yet the Bible says you and I, we were involved in those things before we saved. And such were some of you, but you're washed. And so anyways, you know, I think that the idea that this is understanding that we were all involved in some unrighteousness in our life before we were saved. But yet, when we get saved, there should be that comparison that we are living as a righteous people. And then 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, we got where the Bible describes the love for the world versus the love of the Father. Okay? We know that if we love the world, then there's the love of the Father is not in us. And then last of all, 1 John chapter 3, verses 14, chapter 5, verse 11, but there should be love for other believers. Okay? So these are some identifications as if we were sealed by the Holy Spirit. Go back to your verse real quick tonight. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. In whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of the truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. So I pray this will be a help for you tonight. But the ideal of it is that we cannot know the heart of other people, but we can know them by their fruit. But again, it is not our job to judge people. It is our job to help them to become under the knowledge of Jesus Christ. I believe that wholeheartedly. I not only believe it, I teach it, I practice it. And but that's Bible emphasis right there. And so let's go to the Lord.